so let's again redo some of this. I'm going to have expanded my notes here. So just to give you a better exposure to what exactly. A very quick review that we are talking about a collection or a set of a family of random elements. A. The A here comes from an index set. Here the index set is set of integers. And typically in the context of digital control, index set is positive integers or non-negative integers. So we are talking of a process, a stochastic process, which is collection of random values. It could be finite, it could be infinite set of random values. So each one of them is a different random variable. That's what you have to understand. We will make some simplifications, and in fact now I am going to introduce the most simple stochastic process first, that we gradually understand the concepts. But in its most, you know, what I would say, in its most general form, we are actually considering a set of random variables. Each one of them can have different distributions, different mean, different variance, different high order properties. Moments. So, that is the most general thing. We are going to work with a very, very simplified form of this particular stochastic. So, it's not going to be this complex. Most complex case. Nevertheless, as I said, that this whole theory was centuries to develop, and then it's not so easy to understand it. So I showed you some realizations of stochastic process. I said stochastic process can have different realizations. This was an abstract plot. I'll show you some realization of a real system. Basically, the idea was that associated with each time point, there is a probability density function. That is a model. We are modeling a system that has a random behavior. Don't confuse that the reality is probably much more complex. We are developing a model that says that each one of them can be looked upon as a sequence of random variables, and each one of them has some PDF associated with it. PDF is again a model. Let's say Gaussian density function is a model that we have developed, an idealized model that we have developed to represent random variables. I showed you this data last time. This was temperature measurements collected from a bath, some in period of experiment that I conducted. This is just cold water sum. And you know, there is some water recirculation in this because I am pumping liquid out of it to a system, but not everything. Some liquid is, you know, from the pump is diverted back to the sump. So there is a recirculation. The recirculation causes some heating of the water in the sump, and you can see fluctuations in the temperature. It fluctuates by 2 degrees. This is data collected over some 1 or 2 hours. And I think 5 seconds interval, 400 samples. The drift, and I said that this kind of data you come across in all kinds of stock market or exchange rate fluctuations, signals such as speech, audio video signals, or ECG. I'm going to show you some examples. Now, this is an example I have looked up from I've given here reference. This is from NASA website. This is a line plot of global mean land ocean temperature index. Okay, this is global mean land ocean temperature index from 1880 to present year. A here is year. Okay, so 1880, 1881, 1882. It's convention to connect these points. Actually, these are discrete points per year. Okay, it's a convention. a convention. You can probably think of this connection as interpolation, if you want to. But actually, these are separate types. Nonetheless, they are connected. Now, you see that this is a deviation, the deviation variable. You see this? It's not given in terms of absolute temperatures. Some reference temperature is taken between 1951 and 1980. Some average value is taken between 1950 and 1980. That has been subtracted from the global mean temperature, and the deviation data is reported. This data is of importance in global warming. So, this dotted black line is the annual mean of temperature. Okay. It is drifting, and we would like to know whether there is any relationship between. Now, if you ask me what are the inputs that are relevant here that are causing these changes. Developing a model from first principle is very difficult. You can appreciate it. It's not that it is not possible at all. I used to work on weather predictions. Of course, try to develop models which come from physics, but predicting this completely from physics is a very tall order. It's not so easy. And then what is shown here, the red line which is being shown here, is a moving average. You take average of last 6 years or something. Ignore that moving average right now. That's not important. What is important is the data, which is temperature deviations. The other data, this is speech data. Okay. This is recording of syllable A, ah. Okay. Samples are taken in 10,000 samples per second. This is just first 1,000 samples. Okay. And analysis of such signals is very, very important. This is a time series. Okay. I can view each one of them as a random variable. Okay. What is going to happen after some time? Or what is going to happen at a particular instant, you could predict if you have a model for these random variables. Now, where is this data of interest? This data is of interest when you do speech recognition. So, we have you will find many of these examples. So, first thing which I want to stress here, that the tool that we are going to learn as a part of these lectures is not limited to only process control or control in the world. The modeling or any system where you have data coming, some measurements coming, and if you happen to know some inputs, manual inputs that go in. Weather case probably we are not manipulating, but there might be some inputs that go in like CO2 emission. Correlate CO2 emissions as from 1880 to now to the temperature is changing. Okay. I'm going to now first introduce simplest of the stochastic forces. I'm going to introduce most simplest ideal stochastic forces that I can think of. Okay. This is going to be called as discrete time white mass. Why it is called white? Will come to that, hopefully in this, or maybe getting into the next picture. Fight about brightness. So what is this? Let's go over it. It's a random process of variables E1, E2. Well, whether I start K equal to 1 or I start K equal to 0, doesn't matter. The collection of random variables E1, E2, E3 or E0, E1, E2, E3, where typically K would denote time, sampling time. We are in a digital world where we get data at, let's assume that at discrete time instances. So EK are independent. So E1 and E2, E1 and E4, E1 and EN are independent of each other. The collection of random variables, all of them are independent of each other. Okay. And they are equally distributed. Which means all of them have identical distribution. Simplest random process. Okay? A collection of random variables, all of them are same distribution and they are independent. Okay. bits distribution. If you want to go even simpler, say all of them have Gaussian normal distribution. Simplest. Okay? In fact, what we use most everything means preliminary models is Gaussian normal process of white noise with Gaussian normal distribution. That is the most simplest process that we use. Okay? So, sir, yeah. I guess so. Yeah. Second argument is the from the probability space. Actually, we suppress that here. I should write Ek omega. Omega is the random variable associated at. If you fix yourself to time k, see here this last definition. The first argument is. If you say that zeta is equal to zeta 0, then you get a realization, a particular realization. And if you fix yourself to a time, then the second variable is the random variable. Second argument is the random variable. Okay. So at a specific time, the second argument is the random variable. Okay. So there are two arguments, but you know we cannot keep writing all the time two arguments. So we suppress. So it's a convention to do k. Actually, it should be e k omega. So we are then going to keep writing omega. There are always two arguments. One is fix yourself to a time k, then it's randomness. Now I'm going to assume even more simple. I'm going to assume that this is a zeroing process. Zero mean process. That means if I take mean of Ek at any time point, it is zero. Okay? Simplest way of defining the stochastic process. Okay? And its variance is equal to sigma square. Each one of them, all of them are identically distributed. Each one of them has same variance. Okay? It's a collection of random variables, most ideal stochastic process one can think of. Okay? That is such a sequence of random variables is called as discrete time white noise. As I promised you, I talk about what is so white about this. But one can appreciate that this is the simplest stochastic process you can do. Nothing can be more simple than this. One of them is identically distributed. All of them have zero mean. Okay, and sigma square is variance of each one of them. Okay. So we often call this IID, identically and independently, IID. Okay. A special case of this white noise is Gaussian white noise, where each one of them has Gaussian normal distribution, univariate Gaussian. All of you know what is univariate Gaussian normal distribution. Okay. If you don't know, go back and look into the graduate experience. Okay, so this is the simplest of the process which we are going to use to develop models. This is going to be one of the important signals, stochastic signals. I'm just showing you here three different realizations of this process. How did I do it? In MATLAB, I generated sequence of 10 normally distributed random numbers with variance equal to 1. Three different realizations. If I do the experiment of generating 10 random numbers or 15 random numbers, I'll get three different realizations of this stochastic process. Okay, of this stochastic process. Every time I generate 15 random numbers, they are going to be different. If I view this as a collection, as a stochastic process, and plot it, okay, then what will happen? What will happen at instant 1, what will happen at instant 2, what will happen at instant 3? Perfectly random. Can you see yourself? See, if I fix myself to time 4, then I got these 3 points. Okay? I got these 3 points. So, there is a randomness if I fix myself to a time. Okay? And then each one of them is coming from Gaussian normal distribution. Okay. So this is the realization. Okay. So then slowly you will develop understanding of what is the difference between the process and the realization. Sometimes we keep using it in the literature. So the same stochastic process. What is the stochastic process? Gaussian white noise, all of which have standard deviation equal to 1 and mean equal to 0. Okay. These are the three different realizations of that stochastic process. Okay. The other thing which I have, next thing that I want to consider is something called moving average process. Moving average process. Now let's start. I'm going to fabricate another stochastic process starting from white noise. Okay. Now my EK is a white noise. What is a white noise? This is a Gaussian white noise. You know what a white noise is. We just talked about it. I'm going to introduce a new random variable called VK. Can you see here? Is VK a random process? VK is a random process because it is summation of three random variables. Okay, I have collected some data. Okay, and then I define a new random variable. Think of these as, you know, thought experiments. This is not real. In MATLAB, I can do the simulation, right? I can actually generate a sequence of random numbers, and from that, I can actually fabricate this process. I am not fitting. You are mistaken. I am not fitting. I am saying that each one of them has a Gaussian distribution and one mistake. And I got three realizations. I am not fitting a Gaussian random variable. You are talking of reverse filling. I am not making no attempt to fit any. I am saying that a true process is one where each one of them has. If I observe this process, okay. If I observe three different instances of this process, I will get these three realizations. Okay, I am not right of fitting. Be careful.
So, yeah, I agree in the previous case that instead of that, the random variable is the same actually.
Yeah, random variable is the same. Yeah, I am. See, what is the most simplest thing that you think of? This is most ideal. All of them are equal. See, in many situations we construct ideal models to help us, you know, construct more difficult models. See, for example, you take elements. Will it be a pure resistance error? You have some elements, right? But we model something for pure resistance. Model something for pure elements. And then we say that the real thing is some combination of these two types. So, think of this as a model. Now, I have a model called white noise, which all of them are identically distributed. And this is going to be one of the useful signals in
development. But dice is something else. Ideal white noise. Not Gaussian, but ideal. As white noise.
That is because you know, that is sigma mean and sigma square.
That is
Gaussian. That's an example. No, but I never said that the white noise has to be Gaussian. Gaussian white noise is a special case of white noise. Why I need Gaussian, we will come to that. Okay. You come back to this question a little later, but you know, otherwise it will just go on. It's a very complex. Okay. So we can introduce a moving average process. A moving average process is a new random variable called VK, okay, which is a mean of three points, two neighboring points. If you take EK, EK plus 1, EK minus 1. This kind of move. Averaging we keep doing in practice, right? Now, this VK here is called as a moving average process. Okay? Detail that is part of the movie. It's moving the window of, you know, 1 plus 1 minus. Okay? It's a moving effect. The other kind of stochastic process that can introduce is what is autoregressive process. Okay? Autoregressive process, you can see here, X is the autoregressive process. So, what is the meaning of this? Meaning of this is that current value of x, okay, current value of x is some function of previous value of x. You have seen these kind of equations appear when you are modeling, you know, dynamical systems. So, this kind of a thing would be useful. This kind of process would be useful. So, what it says is that the new value of x is some function of old values of x and a random variable k. k is a white piece. Okay. Here I am constructing some hypothetical. Okay. First one here is called as moving average. Second one is called as autoregressive. Auto-regressive behavior. Typically, the second part is useful when you want to model periodic behavior. Okay. Current depends upon past. So, these two processes are again idealized stochastic processes or moving average process. You see this? These are stochastic processes. Okay. Now, what was the property of white noise? Ek and Ek minus 1, Ek and Ek minus 4, or Ek and Ek plus 4 were not related any which way. Can you say this for Vk here? Or for Xk? No. So, Vk is a stochastic process where Vk and Vk plus 1 are likely to have some relationship. Okay, same thing is true about Xk. Xk and Xk plus 1, Xk and Xk plus 5, Xk and Xk minus 10 will have some relationships. Okay. And this is the feature that we want to use to develop models. I'm just showing you some realization of moving average. I just took the same data. Okay. I took one realization of white noise process. Ek is the white. Blue is the white noise process, and this red here is the moving average process. What I have done is I have taken three points, neighboring points, find the mean. Okay, this is normally used in smoothing. Okay, it is used in many processes. For example, you are reading data for temperature measurements, they are noisy. We use average. So smoothing is, and simplest average, simplest of smoothing, we just take some of past values and find a mean. Right? Okay. So this is how the new process will look like. Moving average process Vk is the red line. This is an example of autoregression process. I took the same data and created autoregression. Autoregression, I just gave you an equation, right? Xk is xk minus 1 minus 0.9 xk minus 2 plus v. Ek is this blue signal and xk is plotted here, which is red signal. Okay. So, I'm able to fabricate new stochastic processes using this basic unit called white noise and some operations on the white noise. And this basic idea I'm going to use in modeling for that. Okay. This is going to be my building block. Moving average process and autoregression process are going to be my building blocks when I develop stochastic models. This is just one visualization. Here is something, here is a concept just see, and we will hopefully develop telling of this over a period of time. Now let's BKB is our stochastic and the values of a random process at n distinct time points. If I take any n distinct, n is could be 1, could be 2, could be 5, could be 10. I have a process which is k going from 0 to 1. I can pick any subset which is finite. I can pick any subset which is finite. This finite subset could be, you know, consisting of n equal to 2, n equal to 5, n equal to 10. Then one can talk of joint probability. See, these are each one of them is a random variable. Okay, you can talk of joint probability distribution subset, which you have written. Okay. So, what is the probability? I can pick up some numbers, say zeta 1, zeta 2, zeta n, and I can define a probability distribution function. Put it here as f, and this function of the probability distribution function is function of n. Now you had this question. This function of n random variables zeta 1 to zeta n, and it is function of your time points you have put up. See, when I am saying this collection, I am not insisting that they should be next to each other. It could be time 1, time 17, time 19, time 200. And I can ask this question: is there a joint distribution? So, when such a distribution exists, then it is called as a finite dimensional distribution function. Most of the times, just you know, when you have to construct such distributions, work with Gaussian variables, and multi-dimensional Gaussian distributions can be defined very easily. Even though this definition is very very generic, ultimately in practice, it will boil down to Gaussian distributions, normal distributions. Then the simplest process, as I said, is the Gaussian process, where all these joint distributions, all possible combinations you can think of, all of them are Gaussian, multivariate Gaussian. That is the simplest process one can think of. Well, even though I am for pedagogic reasons, I am defining all these things. Each one of these concepts will not be directly required when we start working. Okay. So, making the subject development consistent, I will define some well, if all of them are Gaussian random variables, or if all of them are jointly Gaussian, a little more complex than all of them are individually Gaussian, then it is called as a Gaussian process. What is nice about Gaussian distribution? How many moments are required to describe Gaussian distribution? Only 2 moments are required. Mean standard deviation. Okay. So throughout our course, we are going to be worried about Gaussian distribution. They are not really or multivariate Gaussian. So the nice thing about the Gaussian process is that you just need to know mean and standard deviation, and then we are done. Okay. Now we have to find out the movements of these stochastic forces. The first thing is mean of the stochastic, right? What are the 2 movements that are of interest? Mean and variance, right? Mean and variance. If you go to a book, you will get this definition for any variance. Now, F here is the probability distribution function, not a density distribution function, and then you will get this is the definition which looks very complicated. Integral over the sample space, omega is the sample space. That means all possible collection of all possible outcomes. And mu here is the true mean of the stochastic process. And in general, it can be time varying, What is the nice thing about white mass? We need zero for all of them. Okay? So it is not time waste for a white mass. White mass is a very simple thing. The more general definition. I am writing this for the sake of whatever we use to write. I'll give you some example of the simplest, let's take one example. This is discrete process. Yk is equal to cos 2 pi k by 29, okay, plus Ek. Ek is a random process. There is a deterministic signal to this. What is the deterministic signal?
Cos.
Cos 2 pi k by, where k is the time index. Ek is white noise. Okay. Zero means white noise. What is the mean of Yk? I can ask this question. See, where will you get such a signal? Let's say you have some sinusoidal current or voltage in the AC circuit. Let's say you are measuring it. Okay. The current, the true current behaves according to cos 2 pi k by 25. Okay. But you get measurement as a white noise, as an error. And we impose a model that is zero mean white noise. Okay. Then you get this kind of a signal. So the question I can ask is, what is the expected value of this? This is not going to be zero. White noise has zero mean, but expected value of Yk is not going to be zero. So if I take expectation, to take these expectations, what I am, this statement which I have written here, I don't have to compute any integrals. Just see here. So the integrals are written for the sake of defining. We can do some simple arguments and don't have to compute the integrals exactly. Okay. Now yk, expected value of yk is equal to expected value of cos 2 pi k by 25 plus expected value of ek. Do you appreciate this? If I write two integrals, then I can separate them and write this. Okay. Now, what is the expected value of the deterministic signal? The signal itself. Right? What is the expected value of Ek? Zero. It's a zero mean white noise process. Okay. So, what is the expected value of Yk? It is cos 2 pi k by 525. That is the expected signal. That is the expected value of Yk. It's a time varying peak. Yk is a stochastic signal which has a time varying peak. Okay? Do you see this? Okay. Let's take second example. Moving average process. We constructed, we fabricated this process, right? We fabricated a simple process, stochastic process, which was moving average. Let me take mean of this. So, mean of Vk, nothing but mean of Vk plus Vk minus 1. Mean of Ek and mean of k plus 1. Each one of them is a zero mean random variable. What is the mean of Pk? Okay. What is mean of Pk? I can also show in the same manner that mean of autoregressive process is also zero. In a model of using cases which I have constructed, just look at this derivation which I have written here. Now, please remember, when I am doing these arguments, I never computed any integral. So, don't be worried about those integrals which I wrote. But I was working on the example, so I am getting started with this concept. You don't have to compute those integrals right now. Right, thank you. So, I will compute that. Some chicken and egg problems, some things. So we will talk that this, we'll show that this is a literary. So what you say is correct. I'm making an assumption that let mu be the mean of so what I'm saying is that the mean is invariant to translate in time. That's what I'm saying. You take a sequence which is xk minus 1, or I take a sequence I want 3 times, mean will not change. That's what I mean.
then what I can show you is that the real.
So for these simple fabricated nice processes, computing mean of this stochastic process is not, you don't have to compute any integers, you can just work out by, I have a stochastic process. I showed you some stochastic processes. I showed you temperature data, mean temperature data. Is mean temperature data in 1850 relative to mean temperature data in 1900? I mean, we expect that it is relative, we would like to uncover the relationship, okay? And then we have a model, we can develop this relationship. Okay. So, put this question in, in a mathematical framework, is to say that is Vk and Vt are very different, where k and t are two different instances. The data which is global temperature volume or the data which is heat heartbeats. I want to know whether heartbeat at 9:30 has any relationship with heartbeat at 9:30. Okay. There is one more question. There are two different stochastic processes. Stochastic process 1, stochastic process 2. I'm going to show you an example soon of there is one more index called Southern index about variation of temperature and pressure and the fish population. I would like to know whether temperature variation has anything to do with the fish population, or let's say you are administering some drug to a patient. And he's in ICU, you are administering a drug. Every 1 minute you give some dose. Okay. You have a time series. Okay. The question is, what is the relationship between this dose and the way his heartbeat is changing as a function of time? Two time series. Okay. Are they correlated? What way? The two questions. What are the questions that we need to ask, and which is what? So I want to ask two questions. First question is, within a time series, within a stochastic process, are two variables separated in time, are they correlated? Second question, there are two series which I have collected, okay, is this variable affecting another variable in another time series? They are correlated. Then I have reasons to believe that it's not physics, which you probably do not know, but you can at least have a very crude model that talks about relationship between these two. So I'm going to use second moments to uncover this relationship. First moment is not for these idealized processes. You saw that if you take idealized processes, all means are zero. Doesn't help us. We have to look at second moments. What do you define second moment? Again, the definition of second moment is common. Don't bother about second moment. You're never going to compute the second moment. But then, the mathematical definition of second moment, the two random variables is given there. With no joint distribution. I'm going to call this as R subscript V, autocovariance. Covariance. Well, in last lecture, I think I used different terminology. The problem is, if you take different books, there are slightly different terminologies. You can pick up some. So, this autocovariance, second moment of a process, where Vk and Vt are two different times. What happens if k is equal to t? What will you get? You will get variance. If k is equal to t, if you substitute into this formula, you will recover variance. Okay? So, autocorrelation function actually quantifies dependence of random variable with between time instant K and time instant K. To actually run this calculation for this on the data and see how it works. So if I put K equal to T, in this formula, I will recover variance. You should remember that. Okay, if I put K equal to T, I will get variance. If I take K and T different, I will get autocovariance. Second moment of two different random variables separated in time. Every time gap could be in future or in past. I mean, one will be in future and past depending upon various time. And so the question could be, is there a relationship between now and something after 5 days or now and something before 3 days in the area of the time? Go back to simple examples. What is white noise? For a white noise, what should be autocorrelation of a white noise? Because they are independent random variables. Ek, ek plus 1, ek, ek plus 5, ek, ek minus 10 have no relationship. If you take joint variance, it should be 0. Okay? So, white noise as most simple autocovariance function. Okay, white noise is the most simple autocovariance. It is equal to sigma square, but tau equal to 0. Okay? And it is equal to 0. So I am putting this tau here. You see what is tau here? This is ek and ek minus tau. Tau is the gap in the past. Okay. Or it could be gap in the future. So tau can take plus or minus any value. So this is the most simple signal that one can think of. And its autocorrelation function is very, very nice. Okay. You see this autocorrelation function? It is 0 everywhere and it is equal to sigma square where it is k is equal to, the tau is equal to 0. When you put tau is equal to 0, it is ek, 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 ek square. Let's go back to our fabricated process, moving average process. For this moving average process, I want to find out now autocovariance. Okay, I want to find out autocovariance. So, first thing I am doing, find out variance of dt with dt. How do you take dt with dt? Expected value of, there is a typo here. Is this okay? Is this? If I take any two time instants k and t, then covariance of dk dt will be nothing but expected value of dk. We have already shown that dk has zero mean. We have shown this already. Right? For this process. So now I just have to take expected value of dk minus 0 and dt minus 0. I have just written that here. Okay. So this expression here is what I have to evaluate. Okay, first let's look at k equal to t. What happens at k equal to t? Expected value of, so here you will get k minus 1, k, k plus 1, k minus 1, k, k plus 1. If you multiply this, what is the expected value of ek, ek minus 1? Or ek, ek minus, ek minus 1, ek plus 1? So, what remains finally, out of all the 9 terms that you will get by cross multiplying, only 3 terms will remain because all other covariances are 0. Okay, so what remains is only k minus 1 square, k and k plus 1 square. So, this will give you 1 by 3. Do you agree on this? Any difficulty here? I have not computed anything here. Okay. Just I am doing arguments. The arguments are straightforward, particularly for zero mean white noise, very, very straightforward. Okay, my next question is K+1 and K. See this? So this is EK, EK plus 1, EK plus 2, and then EK minus 1, EK, EK. You see this blue two things here? I have taken K plus 1 and now if you multiply, okay, now if you multiply and take expectation, only two terms will remain. This, is there any difficulty with this equation? Let's go, this, look at it, here. So, unlike the white noise, there is no relationship between EK and EK plus 1. But this moving average process, EK and EK plus 1 are correlated. Okay? Are correlated. And you get here 2 by 9 sigma square. Okay? 2 by 9 sigma square. So this stochastic process is more interesting than white noise. It talks about correlation within a process. There's a non-zero correlation within a process. This is probably what we would like to uncover when we go to temperature data. Right? Other things can be derived in a similar manner. You can work it out in the exercise. So I'll just summarize this. I'll summarize, if you do all possible combinations, then the summary is this, that when k is equal to t, you get sigma square by 3. When k is equal to plus or minus 1, that means mod of k minus 1 is 1, that is k is equal to plus or minus 1. But now difference is plus or minus 1, it will get 2 sigma square by 9. Okay. When the difference is 2, okay, you get sigma square by 9. Okay. And if the difference is more than 2, then you will get 0. Okay. So this BK process has memory of 3. Okay, BK process has memory of 3 on the either side. Memory of 2, sorry, memory of 2. Thus, what is happening now is related to what is happening one instant before that and one instant before. So, two instances. But, one, so B and BK and BK minus 3 have no relationship. Okay? Now there is something that I just wanted to note here, this autocovariance to moving average process depends only on the difference k minus 2. It doesn't depend upon where you take it. This is a very special property and we are going to use this. So whether you find out this at k equal to 100 or k equal to 1000 or k equal to 20,000, okay, the relationship between three neighboring points is going to be invariant. That is what this is. And this is a spatial class of cases, called as stationary. Okay. Now we have to define something called autocorrelation. Autocorrelation function. The normalized measure of association between two variables and the values it can take between plus or minus. So what we do is, we divide by the autocovariance, normalize the autocovariance. Okay, I just normalize the autocovariance. Okay. If I fix myself, what is RVAK? Is the variance. Square root of that is standard deviation. Okay, so I'm normalizing the covariance using. You do not know about Cauchy Schwarz inequality for very long. But from Cauchy Schwarz inequality, it follows that this correlation function is always between plus or minus 1. And what is important, it measures the predictability of a series. So, whether at any time t which is greater than k, see, I am standing at k, I want to predict what will happen at time k which is at time t which is higher in future, then can I make some predictions using value VK about VT? VT is a user. Use your version of predictions. How will we start working with their data? If I can predict VT into a linear relationship, I'd like to give you some insight. We'll have to ruminate over this particular slide. It will not come immediately. But suppose there is a relationship between what is happening now and what is happening with the findings. Okay, I'm looking at a patient's data, daily. That's what doctor does, right? When you have a fever and you give you some medicine. The time series data which you get. What are the temperature today? What are the temperature tomorrow? So let's say there is a relationship between V. Then, how will the correlation coefficient look like? 51 if beta 1 is greater than 0. Okay. Which means if there is a positive relationship between VT and DK. Okay. If there is a positive relationship between VT and DK, then the correlation coefficient will be 1. It will be 0 if there is no way you can say that VT is some linear function of DK. Okay. And it will be minus 1 if there is a negative relationship. So, the value of correlation coefficient close to 1, which means there is a strong correlation. Okay. Strong correlation between K and K plus tau. Equal to 0. Suppose value of K and K plus tau is 0. Which means there is no correlation within the series. Okay. And if it is small, then there is negative correlation. So basically, if you investigate the shape of this correlation function, you can If you can construct the correlation function for a given time series, then you can comment upon relationship within this time series. Okay, I'm going to define an ideal stochastic function. Again, these concepts of this ideal stochastic function will take some time to sink in, not a minute. If you think that, you know, you are a modeler and you are constructing an ideal world, okay, in which signals have a nice behavior. White noise is an ideal world for signal. Get data, you will never get true white noise. White noise is an ideal signal. So I am constructing an ideal stochastic process. It's called deeply stationary process. It's a little bit of generalization of something that is very, very useful when you model better. So, deeply stationary random process. Mean is independent of time. Okay. If I have a time series, whose mean is independent of time, okay, which means all of them, all the random variables have the same mean. That is one answer. Okay. White noise is a special case of this. You know me. Okay. But I am taking now a little bit of derivation. I am saying that it is independent of time. At any given time, the mean is same. Moving average process. What are moving average process? Mean is independent of time. All of them have zero mean. Autoregressive process. Mean is independent of time. At any time, the mean is zero. And the autocorrelation function depends only on the time gap. Okay. So, the correlation between the temperature between 1950 and 1945 is same as correlation between function at 2000 and 1995 or 1900 and 1895. Okay, if this is true, I am not saying this is true for the temperature data, but if this thing holds. It is independent of where you take it. You move anywhere in the time series. What matters is the time gap between the random variable which you are considering. Okay. If you have such a process, where the autocorrelation is function of only difference between the two time instances, then such an idealized process is called as weakly stationary process. Okay, so actually what I am saying here is that RVV, that means or RV is just the function of T minus T. It doesn't depend upon where you take it. Then I can just drop this T and T, and then just say R tau. Tau is the difference. Tau 0 means current time, tau 1 means one time difference, tau 2 means 2 time difference. The idealized process is again difficult. The advantage of the idealized process, of course, if I assume that something is behaving like this, I can use time points to do estimation of mean. Although they are saying mean, so I can use data in time to estimate mean variance. The simplifying. Another thing that we need is cross-covariance. Cross-covariance is a measure of predictability of series WT from the series PT. Can I predict changes in the fish population from the changes in the temperature bandwidth? Or whatever the Chisholm index that again, the formal definition of cross-covariance is the value of Vk minus Vk and Wt minus Pwk. This slide that should be T here. Okay. And then you can talk about cross correlation function in the same way as we talked about auto correlation function. Cross correlation function is a normalized cross correlation. This cross covariance will give you. Many times it is convenient to look at the normalized series rather than the raw series. So we import the normalized. This gives you an example of third basic process. They want to find out what is the cross correlation between. Now there are two time series, one is XK, other is EK. XK is a random process, EK is a random process. I can ask question, what is the relationship between XK and EK? Okay. So, now you can appreciate that EK and XK minus 1 are not correlated. EK and XK are correlated. Okay. The way we have defined the process, EK and XK minus 1 are not correlated. So, when I take this expectation, is this clear? What I'm doing here? Okay. Again, there's a typo. Not here. So, okay, it should be here, K. So now I'm going to argue what is the relationship between EK and XK minus 1. EK and XK minus 2. EK and XK minus 2 are not related. EK and XK minus 1 are not related. EK is related to XK. That is the definition of this process, EK and XK are related. Okay. See, in XK minus 1, EK minus 1 will appear, not EK. So, any of these expectations, this should be K here and typo here. And expected value of EK should be EK square. And so, again, this should be XK and this should be EK. XK and EK. So this is RXE. Okay? This is RXE. This is XK and EK. So I can argue about what should be the expected value of each of the terms by multiplying and this fine? Just make this correction. Okay, I'll upload the correct values. So I can talk about RXE K and K minus 2. Okay. So I can talk about covariance between XK and EK minus 2. Okay. And then by doing similar arguments, you can say that this is nothing but minus 0.9. So, you can actually work out the process. Another problem is, here I am doing some, you know, simplified calculations, taking expectations. Here the signals, you have to do the estimates. These signals, you have to do the estimates. So, how do you do this integral? In general, if you were to know this density function, how will you do this integral? That is probably easier to do. You have done a course in maths. If you know the density function, you can actually do this integral. In reality, we may not know the density. We have data coming from the field, like temperature data which is coming from the field. I just skip this and I just tell you one simple thing here. Just look at this last slide. Say that if I want, if zeta is a random variable and g of zeta is some function of the random variable, then expected value of g of zeta can be just estimated by finding out g of zeta at different samples and taking the mean. Okay, you can go over this slide. I don't need to explain this. I'll just put this for completeness and appreciate the next slide. Implication of the last slide. Okay, go ahead and read that slide when I put it. I think it, the old note is there. Just check that. Simplest implication is that, you know, if I have a stochastic process Vk and if I have samples of this stochastic process, I can take the samples, find the mean. That is the mean of the, that is an estimate of the mean. Okay. So, estimate of the mean is developed by that. Very, very important. Very, very important. It's an estimate, it is not a true mean. When I write mu v, it is a true mean. Mu cap is the estimate of it. How do you construct it? Take samples, okay, and find the mean. What about autocovariance? If I give you a realization of a signal, okay, you can compute mean, you can compute autocovariance. If I give you some thousand values of some particular, I give you the speed signal, downloadable. Okay, you can put it on Google, very, very. So this signal, you can find autocorrelation. For autocovariance. Okay. The formula given here is first I estimate the mean. Estimated mean is used to find out this difference between Vk and for the mean. Okay, and then I take this summation here. Okay, this summation will give me autocovariance estimate. Okay, that's why I have this little cap here. Or cap. So, same thing, if I have two stochastic processes, I can compute or I can estimate cross covariance. Okay. I can estimate cross covariance. These are well known formulas of statistics. And this is the implication of the one abstract slide which I have put. How do you conjugate density? Yeah. Right now, I have a signal which is synchronized, perfectly taken at the same instant. Don't worry about it. We are in the ideal network. You are too much worried about it. We are like that. Okay. So, they are much more complex. Okay. We are taking a situation where. So, what if they are not synchronized data? We have an idealized computer with an idealized sampler where it is possible to pick up samples exactly at the same time. So how to do it, don't ask. In reality, it is not possible, but this is the model. So, when you go to a book on computer control system like Astrobot Metal Mark, you talk about idealized sampler where you can pick up multiple measurements at the same instant. And then using, once you have statistics, you can compute, you know, auto correlation, you can compute cross correlation, and so on. Now there is a problem. I said that white noise process, okay, white noise process could have zero correlation. But if I do an experiment in MATLAB, I construct, you know, some generate some 1000 random numbers, sequence of 1000 random numbers, and I try to find out autocorrelation, okay, using this formula which I just created. Okay, what I know from theory is that it should give me zero correlation. See, when I compute, I don't get zero. So what is zero? When will you call? So I have to look for a situation that the autocorrelation is negligible. Okay. I want to come up and say that, well, I got this data, I did an estimate of autocorrelation, but this estimate is not equal to zero, but it is close to zero. What is close to zero? How do I systematically say that something is close to zero? I do this experiment, I will never get autocorrelation. Actually, if I do this experiment, I will never get autocorrelation functions estimated from the real data. Earlier we did arguments which were, you know, integrals, and you don't know those functions. Here you are giving the data. How do I judge if the autocorrelation is small enough to be neglected? Okay. What we do here is that we use one property. Okay, you have to accept this. This is a very deep level. This is great. Large sample distribution of autocorrelation function of a stationary process. Okay. You can actually derive certain theoretical properties of it. You can show that, okay, now, the true autocorrelation function is not a random variable. Estimate of the autocorrelation function is a random variable. Estimate is a random variable. Estimate. See, here, I have started from data and I have constructed an estimate of autocorrelation. Estimate can change with the sample size. Estimate can change with the... So, if I generate 20 different estimates, each one of them will be slightly different. Okay, now, what you can show is that these estimates can have zero mean. Provided the true process is a white noise process, then they have a zero mean. And they have a zero mean with normal distribution, standard deviation equal to 1 by root n, where n is the data length. So n is the data length. So if I take 1000 points, then there's a distribution with standard deviation 1 by root 1000. Yeah. Sample space is the if you take rho, you take autocorrelation function rho v tau as a true value, then you know the sample space is all possible outcomes that you can, all possible estimates that you can derive from. What is the? Not that is. If I take different derivation of the process, I get a different estimate. See, we just felt, because this is a viewer, it's difficult to go back. I show you different realization of the same stochastic process. If you use one realization of stochastic process, you will get one estimate. Okay? If you take another realization, you will get another estimate. Now, what we say is that each one of these estimates is actually outcome of a random variable. It has a true value, and these are just random values that we got. So they are close to each other, they will not be very far apart. not the realization, the estimates. Estimate of both. Okay, there is a random variable which is a random variable. It's a little complex to understand. So, we'll take some time to set. Estimate itself is a random variable. Just think about this. So what I can do, I can develop a confidence interval on this. Develop a confidence interval on. I want to judge whether the estimated correlation is close to zero or not close. Have you done confidence interval at some point? Okay, so you can appreciate that I have estimated this correlation. I am going to generate a confidence interval. I'll show you the actual problem. See, I took 200 samples. Took 200 samples of a random number generated in MATLAB. This experiment you can do. Generate 200 random numbers. Normally distributed variance 1, standard deviation, and mean 0. Okay, this is a MATLAB function for random. You just say random 201, you will get 200 random numbers. I use that formula of autocorrelation. Okay, I know these are Gaussian random variables. Okay, I should get autocorrelation equal to 0. Practically, when I compute, I don't get 0. So, I get autocorrelations which are negligible. Okay, what is negligible? What is negligible? When can I neglect? You see those bars I have drawn there? Okay. So what I have done is assuming that, see, first of all you can see here, each one of them is a random variable. If I take another 200 samples, see, this is an estimate of the autocorrelation at instant, the estimate of the autocorrelation at instant 5. If you take another 200 random numbers, will you get the same estimate? No, you will not get the same estimate. You will get an estimate which is slightly different. Okay, it could be positive here. Might be positive. If you do another experiment, you will get value which is positive. So what we are saying here is that these estimates themselves are random variables. Okay, each one of them has a Gaussian distribution with zero mean and variance equal to 1 by root. 1 by 200. Yes, exactly. Very nice. So, at infinite points, I will get 0 out of 1. But I cannot take infinite. That's why I have to make a call what is close to it. Guarantee you will never get infinite. Right? So, I have to make this call. What is close to zero? What is negligible close to? Can I call this signal a white noise? I can call it white noise because all these correlation values are within this confidence interval. They can be neglected. Even within this, okay. How did I construct this confidence interval? Here. Okay. Let's go back to your notes in first or second year or third year, wherever you do this confidence interval. This alpha I have taken to be 0.99. You have to find out the normal distribution, you have to find out two points where you will get the values between. So I have decided to neglect all the values of estimate that come between these two points, -0.181 and +0.181. If I get an estimate of correlation between these two values, I am going to call it 0. If I get a value which is higher than this, I am going to call it 1. Okay? Just go back and brush up the confidence interval. You don't have anything to do with it. For a discrete time white noise, this is what I get. So, the question that we have answered, given the signal, this is a white noise? It's a white noise because estimates are coming within those confidence intervals for non-zero value. What is this first one? Autocovariance with 0, so that will always be equal to 1. Okay, but a white noise, the autocorrelation function will look like this. Let me contrast this to a real example. Temperature measurements I took from a beaker. Okay, I have just constant temperature in the beaker, water. I have just dipped my thermometer, thermocouple. I am recording data in my computer. Okay, temperature in the beaker is constant. All of you agree. That is the true temperature, whatever it is. Okay, I don't know what it is because I am getting all kinds of data. So the measurements are varying between 26 and 29. What was what is the true one? Okay. So I considered an estimate. The mean is 27 and variance of this data is 0.663. If I find out error between the mean and the data and I put it in the bins, I get a histogram. Okay. Look like the errors are distributed something like Gaussian. Not a bad approximation, right? The larger errors, there are very few larger errors. There are many errors which are close to the mean value. If I actually take this, this is their data, I take autocorrelation. Okay? I do autocorrelation. To find out whether this is white noise or not white noise. Okay? This is the autocorrelation function which matters. So these are the confidence interval bounds. What does it mean? I can neglect everything that is coming here, and this is indeed a white noise. Measurement noise is indeed a white noise. Okay? So I fitted a Gaussian distribution in this data. This Gaussian distribution. Let's look at the global average volume temperature. Okay. I assume that I can look at it as a stationary process. Whether this is correct or not is a different story. I am imposing a model. This is a stationary process. Okay. And then I did autocorrelation function for this. This is the formula which I have given you here. Right? Summation, 1 upon. You know, you can write a little program in MATLAB to do this. I already have the program for it. It will tell you the value. What can you say here? Now, all these values are much above the confidence interval, which means there is a strong autocorrelation, yeah, up to 20 years. What is lag? You know, lag is gap of 20 years. Gap of 10 years, gap of 5 years, gap of 20 years. What happened 20 years back? Okay, and a strong correlation with what is happening now. You cannot, you know, live without what has happened in the past. It is going to haunt you. That's what it says. Okay, this autocorrelation function, just from a random data which we got, the realization of a data which we got, we are able to uncover something happening inside. What is causing this, we don't know. But we know that what happened in the past has a relationship with what is happening now. The same data which I showed you, I have just applied the correlation. Yeah. So those models can be actually mixed and you make a difference. So what you can see is that there is a correlation in the temperature for the last 30 years. So this simple tool, simple statistical measure, is able to tell me that whether what is happening now has relation to what is happening in the past. Fixed data. I just use autocorrelation. Okay, this is autocorrelation. This means you know that there are periodic repetitions. It's visible here. Periodic repetitions are visible here. In fact, autorepetitive process is also get for. So there are short periodic behavior and there is a large periodic behavior. You have seen that in the real day, and which is evident from the autocorrelation. So what is when you're talking what is happening now in relation to what is happening in the past. Cross correlation. I'll just go over this again. But you know, there are two signals, Southern Oscillation Index and fish population. You can talk about cross correlation. Talk in my next lecture, but you can show that they are cross correlated. These are autocorrelations and these are cross correlations. So if the temperature goes down, after 6 months the fish population will come down. You can predict that within this possibility. We'll talk about it later.